In coordination with the governor's office, the West Virginia National Guard is working with DHHR and other state, federal, and local agencies to respond to the devastating floods. Here's a special report by National Guard Specialist Brianna Lawrence.
The effects of the devastating flood in West Virginia can be felt far and wide. In the town of Clendenin, roadways and homes have suffered heavy water damage. The National Guard is out in full force to assist those communities affected in any way possible.
The first couple of days we were here with Surf P. We were doing wellness checks and some reconnaissance to see if there were areas that hadn't been reached yet or people that were stranded. As that died down and the Surf P was recalled, myself and this medical team set up medical coverage in this area in Clendenin because we saw a need for there to be eyes on these people as they come to drop the donations off, to work the donation stands, and for people that are coming in who may have not seen medical help yet.
The National Guard has also been working in cooperation with multiple other response and support agencies.
We've seen everyone from Duracell to the Red Cross to just volunteers of Christian organizations from all over the East Coast. Everyone's been very helpful. The more agencies we have, the more power we have on the ground to help people, so it's been very nice.
Reporting from Clendenin, West Virginia, I'm Specialist Brianna Lawrence.
Joining us now to discuss the state's Emergency Operations Center and the role of the West Virginia National Guard is Major General James Hoyer. General, thank you so much for being here.
Glad to be here.
Could you tell us a little bit about the purpose of the State Emergency Operations Center?
Yeah, so under the Tomlin administration, we focused our disaster response and special events on what we call the Joint Interagency Task Force construct. So all agencies working together in unison at the state level and then coordination between the local and the federal and the state level. The Emergency Operations Center is that key hub that allows us to link all those agencies together, both across state government and with our other government partners.
Can you tell our viewers a little bit about why that's critical? Because I know firsthand I've seen the value of that coordination. What does that do for the people in the state of West Virginia?
Well, as you know, as a small state spread out and in a lot of places that are hard to get to, it's extremely important that we as a state function very tightly in unison across our various agencies. So, for example, in the case of what you and I deal with public health, you have responsibility for public health, and we have guard folks who provide that support to the public health entities to make sure that we get those services out to the people that need them the most.
And I think that is so important. I know that we activated, obviously, during the flood. Tell us how that activation takes place, how quickly is it done, and how many people are present or working during that time frame.
So one of the things we did a couple years ago under Governor Tomlin is we developed a new construct called a state of preparedness. That allows us to bring National Guard personnel in ahead of an event as we anticipate events that might occur. It's important for folks to understand 90% of the men and women of the National Guard are traditional civilians and citizen soldiers, so they have other jobs, so we have to bring them into the fight, as we say. So being able to have that state of preparedness, have folks ready, then that allows us to immediately go into a response mode.
You know, I know the governor feels so strongly about this, and he wants West Virginia to be ready. He's also done a great job of ensuring there's coordination between even the private sector and the public sector. Tell us, who all is involved? What agencies are part of this operations center, both on the public side as well as the private side?
So again, you've got some of the primary entities are, of course, the National Guard, Homeland Security, Emergency Management, Bureau of Public Health, transportation, but you also have forestry, state police, a lot of other agencies that are out there. And then we can't forget the VOAD group and those volunteers. They are critical to our success in the state. And in this particular event, those first responders at all levels, and those folks were key to keeping us from having much more tragic loss of life than we did have in this event.
Now, how quickly were the volunteers activated, General? I mean, I know they're, as you point out, they're a critical part of our team. How quickly can we get your boots on the ground and their boots on the ground to deal with the issues we're facing.
So those law enforcement, first responder, and guard folks were in it as the rains were coming. Those folks were filing in and doing those search and rescue operations. Almost simultaneously, we started to get volunteer groups like the Red Cross, VOAD, and others into the operations center and being prepared for that next wave of the response.
I mean, it's amazing when you think about it. I know that there was such a quick response to everything that we had out there, and that it was a very well-coordinated response. You know, is there, you know, from the perspective of the West Virginia National Guard, we know that there are so many men and women who are out there that you know, are part of this. How many active Guard members did we have during this disaster working closely with the Emergency Operations Center?
So at the height of the event, we had 850 National Guardsmen. We're down today, down to about 150, and that'll be a steady state probably through December, before we're able to close out our piece of this, but 850 at the height of the event.
Can you talk a little bit about what specifically, what is your role as the National Guard? What did you do during this disaster? Because I know our viewers need to know how critically important it is to have that National Guard by our side.
So in the beginning, of course, along with those first responders, that search and rescue mission, whether it was medevac helicopters flying in and doing hoist operations or high water vehicles going in, and then the next phase for us is what we call our CAT teams, community assessment teams, and those are the folks that go out with our interagency partners and go door to door and make sure that our citizens are taken care of. So that may be delivering medication to an elderly veteran who's lost all their medication, and if they don't have their insulin, then they're not going to be able to survive. Then you've got the infrastructure work, working with various agencies to bring public infrastructure back up and running. And then across that is also the medical piece that we work with your agencies on. And then from there, it just depends on what the governor tasks us to do.
Now, I know currently you were talking about 150, you know, guardsmen still out there, still working in our communities. What types of things should we expect to see from the guardsmen during this time?
So at this point in time, one of our biggest activities is that debris removal piece. And now we're going into a phase where we're going to take and do the demolition work of those houses that were totally destroyed in this event, and then be able to bring that level of normalcy back to our communities. So debris removal will be one of the big things that folks will still see from us at this point in time.
You know, I know that's critically important to some of these communities, because they're gutting out their houses, they're trying to clean up things and get back to normal. As you talk about, normalcy is so important to them. Are we able to just take that debris and move it out of those communities? There's a process involved in that. There's been a lot of questions about that, I know, from people in the community.
There's a process involved, and particularly when you're dealing with demolition of homes, that debris becomes hazardous material, so it goes through a specific process to be moved and then to go to a certain type of landfill and make sure we don't do any additional harm or damage by doing that debris removal.
If people have questions, is there a particular website or something they can do to get their questions answered?
They can go to westvirginiaflood.com, but also what we encourage folks to do is work through their local emergency management office. So call your county emergency manager, ask for assistance, and then they'll push that up through the appropriate chain at the state level.
Is there a personal story? I mean, I find that during these type of events, there are stories out there, people that, you know, just go above and beyond. Anything that just strikes you to share with our viewers?
Yeah, I had a group of National Guardsmen who were assigned specifically to work with the Clendenin Volunteer Fire Department. And at the height of the event, they rescued over 80 people. And there were some stories about the volunteer firefighters having to hold on to the gutter of a home in order to stabilize a boat, or the young Black Hawk pilot who flew into the middle of a bad situation to rescue a lady who had complete break of her femur. So those first responders, law enforcement personnel, those are the folks that really helped us reduce the number of casualties that we had in this event.
Well, thank you, General, and there's heroes everywhere. I appreciate all that you do.
Thank you.
That's all the time we have for today's show. Remember, you can always follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and our website. I'm Karen Bowling, Cabinet Secretary for the West Virginia Department of Health and Human Resources. Thank you for watching the State of Health.